Welcome, everyone, to our virtual worship service here on the fourth Sunday after Epiphany. My name is John Sawchuk, and I'm a member of the leadership team here at Grace Street United Church. I will be one of today's presenters, along with Dina Greer, Deborah Holoka, Brent Poole, and Kathy Welby. We will start off the service by lighting the Christ candle. We light this candle, remembering that the light of Christ is always present. It is always there, inviting us to grace.
Continue with our territorial acknowledgement. We are gathered for worship and work in Treaty 1 territory, which is also the homestead of the Métis Nation. For thousands of years, Indigenous peoples walked this land and knew it to be the center of their lives and of their spirituality. We offer our commitment to living with respect with all of our relations. And this morning's announcements, there's three announcements. I have one on behalf of Kathy. And then Luann also has an announcement, and Kathy's going to follow up with an announcement. First, we are pleased to announce the formation of the Loaves and Fishes Interest Group. The mission of this group is to work in collaboration with other community outreach groups and ministries to provide lunches to the marginalized folks in our city. We will be supporting one project per month. If you would like to be a part of this interest group, please contact Kathy Welby to find out more details. The first project date is set for February the 14th. And I'll turn it over to Luann with an announcement, and then Kathy can follow with an announcement after Luann.
Thank you, Brent. Good morning. I'm Luann. As chair of your leadership team, I'm sure you're all remembering that last year, I can't remember in what month, we agreed that our annual general meeting would be held March 6, 2022. The leadership team met this week, and we decided that was we'd like to push the meeting back a bit. So we have scheduled the annual general meeting for the 20th of March, 2022. There will be more details to follow, and of course, you'll receive an annual report before that time. Thank you.
Good morning, and yes, I'm Kathy. We have reached the last Sunday of January. Yay. That means it is time for me to say a huge thank you on behalf of the worship team to Millie Lewis, Jamie Soskowski, and John Sawchuk for leading our worship services since the departure of our student minister. We are truly blessed to have folks amongst us willing to share their faith and to lead worship. And now we turn the calendar to February, and we will continue to gather for worship on Zoom. The leadership team will be reviewing the status of in-person worship at our February 16th meeting, so stay tuned. But now back to the worship news for February. Since September, Reverend Virginia, or we call her Ginny, Coleman, has been our pastoral charge advisor. Ginny is the minister at Clandeboy and Winnipeg Beach United Churches. After listening to our conversation, wondering who would lead worship in the months beyond January, Ginny extended an invitation to work in collaboration with her churches and share the worship time. Best of all, Ginny would prepare the services and preach. What an exciting opportunity for us. Dina and our wonderful music ministry will be part of the services. And Ginny's church does not have music at this time, so they are super pumped about that. We will also have one or more volunteers assisting with the service, much like we do now. So even though we are visiting another church, Gray Street will be very much a part of the February services. Technology has been a gift from God during COVID. It has allowed us to stay safe and to continue staying in touch and worshiping together. Now is our chance to meet and worship safely beyond our church community. Share this news with others and join us as we make new friends in our faith journey.
Now our call to worship. Here we are, Lord, your creatures gathered together before you, gathered together to praise you and worship you. This is your day, and we thank you for giving this day to all of us. Help us to always to remember that each day is a blessing and a gift from you, for we are not owed anything from you. Be with us in our midst, and let us feel your breath upon our faces. Hold us close to you each and every day of our lives. Amen. Our opening prayer. Lord God, we are here today to offer to you our sacrifice of worship. We are here to listen to your word, to bring to you the concerns of our hearts, and to join together in fellowship. Speak to us through scripture, hymns, prayer, and silence. Grant us ears to hear, hearts to listen, and lives prepared to do your will. Amen.
Jesus, teaching ravens bold, let us serve you, young and old. Let us faith-filled workers be, all around your wisdom see. Let us play and dance and sing, your goodness find in everything. Jesus, friends so strong and true, show us good, brave work to do. Show us those who need a friend. All things broken, help us mend. Free our minds and stretch our care. Teach us to serve you everywhere.
God gives us many wonderful gifts, such as the ability to speak well, spiritual understanding, or a heart for giving to the needy. As the Apostle Paul worked to spread the good news of Jesus, the church in a place called Corinth began to argue over which gift was the best. Paul wrote to this church to remind them that love is the most important gift of all. In fact, Paul would tell the church of Corinth that without love, every other gift God gives becomes meaningless. Love is the only way to use all other gifts as God intended. Some people are gifted in speaking the truth of God. When people with this magnificent gift are filled with the love of God and speak about what He has done in their lives, their audiences stop and listen. Their words help to teach about Jesus and to open otherwise cold, hard hearts. But without love, these same words are empty and have no meaning. The Apostle Paul said, "Without love, a person with this gift is a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal." People gifted with spiritual understanding of who God is and His mighty power know what God is capable of and what that means for our lives. People with this gift, who are filled with the love of God, can confidently face any difficult situation and never fear, because they know God is more powerful than anything they may encounter. The Apostle Paul writes that while people with this gift can have a faith that moves mountains, without love, such miracles will look like nothing more than cheap magic tricks. God gives some people hearts that care for others. Whether they are giving money, time, or talent, these people are following Jesus' command to love others as Jesus loves us. But Paul explains that if a person gave away everything, including his own life, he gains nothing if it is done without love. Without love, the giving this person does is not meant to help others and glorify God, but is an attempt to show how great the giver is. So, if these powerful and wonderful gifts are nothing without love, what is love? Paul explains that love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous of what other people have, and it does not brag or act proud. Love is not rude, selfish, or quick-tempered. Love doesn't keep a list of all the wrong or bad things everyone has ever done. Love does not find happiness in evil things, but is delighted by the truth. Ultimately, love is outward, giving, and selfless. It's no coincidence that these descriptions of love also describe Jesus. Jesus is love. Paul explained how temporary these gifts are, using the example of a child growing up. When children mature into adults, they can see life is bigger than themselves and their own personal needs. According to Paul, on earth, we are like children. We can only see part of the picture. But in heaven, we will have an understanding that is perfect and true. In heaven, we will fully grow up in Christ. Love is so important for us to focus on because of all the magnificent gifts God gives us, love is eternal. Love is at the heart of everything God does and asks us to do, making it something we should focus our lives on. The love we experience on earth is good, but in the presence of God, once we're in heaven, love will not only be felt, but also will be seen. When we see the face of God, we will truly know what love is.
Our prayer for illumination. Jesus, sometimes as we receive the scriptures, we are afraid or we become confused. Help us to wisely discern the words of life and love you are teaching us today. Amen. And our scripture based on the children's story that we just heard from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 to 12, the gift of love. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part, but when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, and I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to my childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And our second reading this morning is from Luke chapter 14, verses 21 to 30. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown.' But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except to the widow of Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elijah, and none of them was cleansed except for Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogues were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of town, and led him to the brow of a hill on which their town was built, so they might hurl him off the cliff. but he passed through the midst of them and went on his own way. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Today's reflection is about the scripture from Luke, specifically Luke chapter 4, verses 28 to 30. When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up and drove him out of the town and led him to the brow of a hill to which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. This is how it ends, the story that began last Sunday. It is Jesus' first sermon in his hometown synagogue. Word had spread to all of the amazing things he had been doing all over the place. We can imagine the headlines. Hometown boy makes good. But how quickly things can turn, and turn bad. Ugly and very bad. They wanted to hurl him over a cliff and be done with him. And why? All because they wanted a piece of him and his power. And that seems fair enough, doesn't it? They wanted to see water turned into wine, the lame heal, recovery of sight to the blind, the whole nine yards. They wanted to see it and experience it right here in Nazareth. And right now, thank you very much. And so do we. That is all they wanted. That is all we want. We are members of his community. We are his people. We are faithful. We want a piece of the action right here, right now, just like the good people of Nazareth. They felt they deserved at least that much. Didn't they contribute to his upbringing? Didn't they put up with his unusual parentage? Didn't they go to synagogue faithfully every week? Didn't they study God's word every day and pray morning, noon, and night? Didn't they feel proud about hearing accounts of his marvelous deeds that he had come from Nazareth? He's one of us, they say. He is ours, they say. Isn't that why we keep coming back Sunday after Sunday ourselves to eat his body and drink his blood, to claim him as our own? Isn't he ours? But listen to his unsympathetic response. He knows what they're thinking before they even say it. He goes to great pains to remind them that our God works in mysterious ways, that God's power is often focused on strangers far outside the friendly confines of our cozy little communities of faith. He reminds them that Elijah was sent to a foreign widow in Zarephath, that Elijah cleansed the dreaded Syrian, a Syrian no less. There were people in need right here in our own community, yet he reminds them God has always looked out for those in need beyond the community of faith, beyond the boundaries of our towns, our countries. God's power is not ours. God is not ours. Rather, we are his. They didn't want to be reminded of the biblical story, the story of the community of faith. They wanted to run him out of town on the proverbial rail, tarred and feathered, and leave him from dead at the bottom of a cliff. Just as the people had done when they heard the young prophet Jeremiah, they hurled him to the bottom of a well so that it could be done with his constant proclaiming of the word of the Lord. And you should see the bottom of those town cliffs in Israel. Often they are garbage dumps. They wanted to hurl him to the garbage dump among the fires and the ashes that are always burning down there. Yet somehow he manages to get away. He escapes like his people had escaped from Egypt so long, long ago in that first Exodus, after that first Passover. All this because they really did not hear him in the first place. Our lectionary suspects we have missed it as well. This must be why we get this story 2 weeks in a row. He says, today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. This scripture is the 61st chapter of Isaiah, where the prophet proclaims God's care and reversals of fortune for all those in need. The operant word, as always, is all. They did not want to share God or God's care with all. God's care is ours. This Jesus is ours. They do not want to hear about a God who cares for Syrians and Zarephathians and all those foreigners. They want God's power and care right here in Nazareth, and in Nazareth only. He is one of us. He is ours, they say. They missed what he says. This scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. Our hearing ought to result in our participating in welcoming strangers, even Syrians and Gentiles of all kinds from all over the world. Our hearing this word ought to result in our doing the work Jesus does. And he will tell them later at his Last Supper, those who hear God's word will do even greater things than these, greater things than Jesus. Jesus reminds them that as a covenant partners with God, going all the way back to the wilderness, the Exodus, and the Ten Commandments, that they were the people appointed and anointed by God to live their lives in such a way so as to be God's demonstrational community of faith, hope, and charity for all people. Or as Paul would have it, God's community of love. What do you say with all these stories and proverbs are in effect? Get with it. Turn water into wine yourselves. Bind up the brokenhearted. Give hope to those without vision. Liberate the oppressed. Release people from their debts. God has given you the vision of the year of the Lord's favor. Live that kind of life. You don't need me around here. You are already God's people, called to do God's work, just like me. He is also saying, do not think that just because you are faithful and in covenant with God that you have some kind of lock on God's power. You do only in the sense that you give that power to others, real others, really other others, like Syrians and all manners of strange other people outside of Nazareth, outside of our little demonstration community. That is, our God is not a God who lives only in Israel, our country, the Christian tradition, the church, our denomination, our parish, whatever boundaries we wish to set. God is not ours. Jesus is not ours. We are his. And we are to go beyond the boundaries we have set, just as Elijah, Elisha, and Jeremiah did. Jesus, Paul, and all those who have truly heard the word of God in their hearing, in their hearts, and in their lives, know this and live this. God calls us to work where and when God pleases. If the scripture is to be fulfilled, it must be in our hearing it, our embodying it, our acting upon it, literally our being it. And to become the fulfillment of the word of God, we need to go, let go of all notions that Jesus, like the hometown kid, is ours. Begin to figure out what it means that we are his. He has a special claim on us, not we on him. What he said that day in Nazareth is just as true today. Live the life Isaiah proclaimed, and God will see to it that all your water is wine, and not just any wine, but good wine. Wonderfully good wine that will warm your hearts and make you glad that the Spirit of the Lord has anointed you to do these things and more. All these things and more. Our cups will be filled to overflowing, and all the world will see that the good news of Christ shines through all that we say and all that we do. This is how we will become a community of love, a people of faith, hope, and charity, a people who know that we are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Amen.
Thank you.
God's blessings are all around us. For all that we have and for all that we are, we give God thanks and praise. If you wish to make a financial contribution today and are not on par, you can visit our website, graystreetunitedchurch.com, and make an offering under the donation tab. And also, if you're watching this service as a recording, don't forget to press the like button on the recording of this service. Thank you.
Grant us God the grace of giving, with a spirit large and free, that ourselves and all our living we may offer faithfully.
As we all do our part, as we all contribute our time, talents, and finances, our prayer is that each gift will be given so that the needs of this church and the wider community in which we live are met. With thankful hearts, these offerings are made to give glory to God and the missions we are given. Amen.
First of all, good morning to everyone. And thank you, John, for that moving sermon. It was a wonderful lead-in to my presentation today. God is love. In the fall, I reported that I was going to engage in a course called Let Justice Flow. It was led by Linda Trono, a diaconal minister who works out of West Broadway Ministry. The goal of the program was to educate a group of people from several churches, but also to encourage them to engage in practical participation in the three One Just City outreach sites. It had a course outline which indicated who might be speaking to us and what topics would be emphasized each meeting. There are 12 people in the course, and we were scheduled to meet every second Tuesday through to March. The goal was to educate those taking the course about the lives of people who live with poverty. I said at the time that I would report back so that I could share some of my learning. We were able to meet in person until just before Christmas, and that was excellent as we got to know each other and reach a level of comfort to be able to share our thoughts easily. Linda gave us material to read, which really stretched my ability to learn. We started with a Bible study-based document that laid out how theologians have interpreted the Bible and God's intentions for us through the years as we live in a world with those who are in need. That one was the first reading assignment. It felt like reading a master's level analysis in a theology course. It was reassuring to find that almost everyone in our humble group was feeling the same way. I did learn about three different ways that people may view the role of God in our lives: the individual, the interpersonal, and the intergroup. It made me think about my faith. Is it a faith that means God takes care of me, in which my prayers all revolve around my life and my needs? That's the individual faith. Is it a faith that brings me to church and community in my congregation, and now my prayers are for my church and the people who attend there? That's the interpersonal faith. Or is my faith that one that connects with groups in the larger world in a desire to be one with all the variations of humanity? And that is the intergroup faith. The conclusion to that learning session was that God wants us to care for all the people in our community and to find the humanity in all of us. Wow. It really came through well, and she presented it so well. I've never been so aware of what it really means. We have learned about who has the power in our society, who has the privilege, and what racism can mean in a person's life. One session gave us a personal awareness of the financial services our government provides for those in need. It included an activity in which we were separated into pretending family groups and given different low-income life circumstances, and then asked to pick up a random card of some life event each time around that would affect our family group. I was in a trio that was labeled one adult with two children. Another group was a person who just got out of jail. Another was a single senior, and another was a couple with no children, and so on. There were about eight variations of family groups. We used Monopoly money and we were given a designated income each round and had to pay our rent and our food. Events that could occur when you picked up a random card could be negative or positive to your family. A bad toothache and a need for dental work would be nothing for my group, where the income for a single parent with children was higher than the others. But it was devastating for the person who just got out of jail, who was given very little support for extras, and very tough for the senior who was under 65 in poverty. It was revealed that the same senior, once they passed the age of 65, suddenly gained financial benefits and could lead a much healthier life. We came to realize that some who are struggling in our society are cared for, and some are just left to their own resources while struggling with all sorts of challenges through no choice of their own. We have more sessions with fascinating presenters to look forward to, and then I hope to report back again. Thank you.
Our prayers of thanksgiving. God, we pray for your church here on earth that we all may be one. Grant that every member of your church may truly and humbly serve you, that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for all those in authority in your church, that they may be faithful ministers of your word. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the earth, that there may be justice and peace on earth. Grant us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that your works may find favor in your sight. Have compassion on those who suffer from grief or trouble, that they may be delivered from their distress. Give to the departed eternal rest, let light shine upon them. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy, that we also may come to share in your heavenly kingdom. We pray for our needs and those of others, whether within your church or without, using the words that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
God says, be still so you may hear the words I whisper in your ear. If you will listen, you will know I'm with you always, where you go. God says, look up and see the prize I've placed you right before your eyes. Find beauty in the forms of earth, the cause for wonder and rebirth. God says, come here, I need your voice. Please teach my people to rejoice in who you are, in what you do. Your life will show my love for you. God says, reach out, the world's in need, and once a word, a soul, a deed, I send you forth.
Go in peace, hold in your heart the certainty that the spirit of love and life is always with you. When your heart is torn apart, or when you soar with joy, you are never alone, never apart from the spirit that resides within each of us, that guides our lives and cherishes us always. Take comfort. Blessed be. Amen.